say welcome to everyone. I'm so thrilled to be here with my Senator, Kirsten Gillibrand, as well as the Attorney General of California, Kamala Harris. And we're going to get right to it. Give it up for both of these great women. All right, so let me start at the very beginning, as Julie Andrews would say, or Maria Von Trapp. You grew up in Berkeley, Oakland, and Montreal. Your dad was one of the first black economics professors at Stanford. Your mom was an endocrinologist, a breast cancer researcher. She was Indian. And tell us a little bit, if you could, Kamala, about your childhood and the forces at work that helped influence the woman you've become.
Well, there were a couple. My parents met when they were graduate students at Berkeley in the 60s. They were active in the civil rights movement. So my sister and I joke that we grew up surrounded by a bunch of adults who spent full time marching and shouting about this thing called justice. And that certainly had an influence on the profession that I chose. But, you know, I also grew up with a mother who had two goals in her life, which is to raise her two children, her two daughters, to do well, and to end breast cancer. And so she would take us to the lab with her after, you know, school and on weekends. And I grew up then surrounded by this environment where these people would work under this hood, unburdened by what has been, believing in what can be, and in particular, what can be that will improve people's lives and make their lives better. And, you know, in large part, that's why I'm so excited about the innovation that's happening right here in our backyard, because it is absolutely fueled by an understanding that we can be what we imagine. We don't have to be burdened by what has been.
And Kirsten, your parents were both attorneys. I know your mom was one of three women in her law school who graduated from her law school as a member of her law school class. Tell us, how would you answer that same question? Because I know that your mom was a huge role model for you, and I know that sports played a really important role in your upbringing as well.
Well, I had two very strong role models growing up. One was my mom, and the other was my grandmother. And my mother taught me to be exactly myself, and the way she taught me that was by living her life the way she did. Not only was she only one of three women in her law school class, but she made all the clothes we wore, our most beautiful clothes when we were little, these beautiful dresses. She loved to cook, she loved to bake, but evenings with my mom, she'd be on the phone back when phones had cords, pulling the cord the full length of the kitchen, talking about an adoption case while making dinner, while saying, "Hi, honey." And by the time she was my age, she was also a second degree black belt. So she did things quite differently. She didn't just cook the Thanksgiving turkey, she shot the Thanksgiving turkey. So my grandmother was also a role model and a trailblazer. She worked her whole life. She was a secretary in the state legislature, and she recognized 75 years ago that women had very little voice in politics or public life. And so she realized that the best way to amplify her voice was to organize other women to be heard together. And so they created a grassroots organizing principle that women's voices needed to be heard. So they did the door-to-door work, the envelope stuffing, the phone banking, and they really ran modern-day elections. And you know, over the next 20 years, you couldn't get elected in Albany if you didn't have the blessing of my grandmother and her lady friends, because they did all the work. And so I grew up just watching them both be exactly themselves and having this notion that women's voices really do matter and that what you do with your time can really make a difference. In terms of sports, sports are great, particularly for women if they ever want to run for office or be in a competitive industry, because what sports teaches you is that it's okay to lose, it's okay to fail, that you actually know how to compete, you can win and lose, and you can win by losing because you learn about who you are as a player, how you need to develop your skills further to win next time. And it creates an ability to be competitive. And so when I ran my first campaign, I wasn't afraid to lose. I wasn't afraid that it was going to be a battle. It would be rough. It would be, you know, just like I play tennis, so of course your opponent's going to hit the hardest serve he can, but it doesn't mean you can't hit it back. And that's the principle you learn through sports.
And what was it about law that appealed to you? I mean, both of you obviously went on to law school. And why were you drawn to that?
Well, again, growing up in the heart of the civil rights movement, the heroes among many of that movement were the lawyers. They were the architects of the civil rights movement. It was Thurgood Marshall, Charles Hamilton Houston, Constance Baker Motley, who understood the skill of this profession of law to translate the passion from the streets to the courtrooms of our country and do the work of reminding people who unfortunately still need reminding of that great promise we articulated in 1776. We are all and should be treated as equals. So at a very young age, I thought that's, you know, those are the heroes. That's the kind of work that is good and noble and meaningful. And so I, at a very young age, actually decided I wanted to be a lawyer.
You became a lawyer, Kirsten. You were working for Davis Polk. You were defending tobacco companies. Is that right?
I worked on a lot of cases when I was at Davis Polk. And when you're a young associate, you don't really pick and choose. You do what you're asked to do. But the reason why I wanted to be a lawyer is because I loved the way my mother was able to help people navigate a complex legal system. She did family law. So I loved that she could help someone adopt a baby or buy their first house and make things that are complex less complex for regular people. So I really wanted to be a lawyer because I wanted to learn how to be an advocate. And that training has really helped me because what you learn through the law is how to look at a whole host of facts, very complex issues, and you simplify them to the truth of the issue, to the core element. And it's really helped me when I'm questioning generals in an armed services hearing and I begin to hear the blah, 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 I can go right after them and say, you know, are you saying, you know, that, so I can really be aggressive and I can actually get to the heart of the matter very easily because of that training. It's really made a difference for me.
And I know you had an aha moment. So you're practicing law, obviously probably doing really well at a big firm like Davis Polk. And you see Hillary Clinton giving that speech in Beijing. Mm. And you suddenly say, I want to do something more with my life.
Yes. So I'm working at the big firm in New York City, doing lots of complex corporate litigation. And I watch our First Lady go to China. And I noticed, because at Dartmouth, I was an Asian studies major. I learned Mandarin. I studied in Beijing. And I see our First Lady giving the speech that women's rights are human rights and human rights are women's rights, which is a very powerful statement to be said from that stage in Beijing to the world. Because obviously China was far behind us in any women's rights movement.
And you were an Asian studies major,
yeah.
So you'd spent time in China.
Well, what I was
China.
Most upset about, Katie, is that I wasn't invited to the conference. Why wasn't I invited? Well, I realized I wasn't invited because I wasn't involved in politics. And so that's what created this opportunity for me to realize if I wanted to be part of these national and international conversations, I really needed to get involved. And so that's what started me on my path to get involved in politics. And it was really watching Hillary and seeing her as a role model of someone who was using her life to make a difference that made me want to leave the law and focus more on public service.
And why, for you, Kamala, public service rather than private practice?
Well, you know, when I was in law school, about my second year, my family gathered around and said, okay, Kamala, so what are you going to do in your fight for justice? And I was very excited. And
gosh,
I,
no pressure.
Well, no, exactly. But that was essential. There was no question in our family, you will figure out how to serve. And so they all gathered around, okay, what are you going to do? And I was very excited. And I said, well, I've decided I'm going to become a prosecutor. And I was very excited about that. And my family looked at me for the most part and thought that was a very curious decision. And for some of them, I had to defend the decision like one would a thesis. But I will say today, after a career as a prosecutor, what I said then. Law enforcement has such a profound and direct impact on the most vulnerable among us, and has as its responsibility, as its job, to be a voice for the voiceless and the vulnerable. And in the process of giving safety, it is the job also to give dignity to the most voiceless and vulnerable. And so that's the work that I decided I wanted to do. And frankly, I think that because of my background, you know, roots in the civil rights movement, career prosecutor, I have witnessed what I think is essentially a false choice that's been presented about this approach to life, which is that you are either in favor of public safety or in favor of civil rights and civil liberties. It's a false choice. You can be both. And that's how I've approached my work and my public service.
I know both of you would like to see many more women choose this path and be involved in public service, get involved in politics. But I think the campaign process seems so brutal, and politics has become so rough and tumble and really just nasty and vitriolic. Tell us a little bit about your experiences, both of you, running for DA and Attorney General, and Kirsten running for Congress.
Well, one of the reasons why I just wrote this book Off the Sidelines is because I have this very firm belief that women's voices are necessary and important, and they need to be heard in all aspects of decision making, whether it's the PTA meeting, whether it's the local town councilor, whether it's Congress. And it's the absence of women's voices that unfortunately leave our country less strong. We only have 20% in the Senate. We only have 18% in the House. And my personal experience has been anytime a woman is at that table, she will bring up different issues, different problems, different solutions. And we've proved it out in corporate America. When even one woman is on a corporate board, that company is 40% less likely to have to restate their earnings. Think that through. That's a really valuable benefit. And it's the life experience that is different. And so for a lot of women, they don't want to run for office because they don't like the political climate. They will look at it and say, it's too ugly, it's too negative, I hate the negative ads. I believe if you had publicly funded elections and you had standards for campaign ads, you would have a lot more women running for office because all the billions or millions that are spent in negative campaign ads would not be spent. And that would change. It would change the players. It would be changing who would be willing to run for those places.
But until then, how do you encourage more women to get into the fray? And what is the right path? I mean, obviously, you guys, I think, had a very specific path, but all sorts of people can become involved in government and public office.
I think we need a call to action. And I liken it to what Rosie the Riveter was during World War II. If you remember Rosie the Riveter, it was an iconic advertising campaign with a woman with her sleeves rolled up. And the slogan was, "We can do it." And 6 million women entered the workforce because of that ad campaign by the end of World War II, because the campaign did two things. It told women they were needed, and they were told they could do these jobs. I want to create that same call to action through my book, that number one, women's voices are needed, and that if they're heard, they will make the difference. And women will respond. If they know they're needed, if they know they could change the outcomes, they will do it. And that means rising to be at the PTA meeting, to be at that community decision-making hearing, to aspire to make decisions at their companies, aspire to maybe run for Congress someday.
I know that, Kamala, you've compared campaigning to the courtroom, mm-hmm. right? Like a marathon trial. How grueling was it, and how, you know, what were some of the challenges that might have been specific to your gender that you had to deal with?
Well, I have several thoughts. When I was first elected District Attorney of San Francisco and when I was first elected Attorney General of California, I was the first woman in both positions. And so reporters would come up to me with a very original question. So what's it like to be the first woman, insert the DA, AG? And I'd say, well, I don't know how to answer that because I've always been a woman. but I'm sure a man could do the job just as well. you know, Kirsten has mentioned a number of very important points, and I think that it is very important to realize that women, when they run for office, are not running to be the first woman. They're running because they actually believe they're going to do a better job than the other people in the field. And so we want to support that, and that's another way of talking with women, to build up their confidence to know that you are running because you have a legitimate purpose, you have a goal, and you have the credentials to actually do the job well. And so we want to support that. You know, when I first ran, however, for district attorney, and again, back to my mother, and very similar, I think we have this background. My mother was a great cook. She would sew for us at night. I mean, the whole thing. And she sat me down and she said, okay, Kamala, so I'm all for this, because I challenged an incumbent who had started out at 6 points in the polls, which is 6 in 100. Nobody thought we could do this. And by the way, when we got to 12, I knew we could win. But she sat me down and she said, okay, Kamala, you have to realize that still in this society, there are a couple of myths. And one of them, contrary to reality, is that women are not yet in a position where they can be in control of two things: your safety and your money. In spite of the fact that the woman is the lioness, the tigress in the household, protecting the family, she is the one at night sitting at that kitchen table paying the bills. But there are still certain perceptions about what women can do and do well that we need to acknowledge and then defy. But in large part, I think that it is about mentoring women. It is about letting them know that there is a path for them and that they will be nurtured and protected in that process, just like anyone else, just like men. You know, that is part of, I think, what we can all talk about in terms of our success. Mm-hmm. None of us arrived here on our own. There were a lot of people for me, of every ilk of human being, who supported the process along the way and gave me the confidence and the encouragement to do what I do. And I'm sure that the last panel of fellows would say the same thing about their careers.
Let me ask you, Kirsten, once you got to Congress, and I guess specifically to the Senate, your book got a lot of attention about some of the comments that that those who shall not be named made about your physical appearance.
Yeah.
And I admired how you kind of took it in stride, and you wrote in your book, I'd like to spend, you're very candid, you were saying, you know, you worry about your weight, and you said, I'd like to spend less time thinking about my appearance. I suspect the same is true for nearly every woman in America, especially those in the public eye. I'll drink to that. Mm-hmm. And I can't believe I'm lobbing this softball, but are women treated more harshly because of their appearance? And how can we change that? Or do you just kind of deal with it? Which I think is what you've done.
Yeah. Well, it is what it is. So, you know, there's far more interest in how women, their appearances are. But in that chapter, I talk about challenges, because in each industry, the issue of appearance can impact a woman differently. And in politics, the studies all show that if your opponent comments on your appearance, positive or negative, it undermines your credibility in the eyes of the voters. So in my first campaign, my opponent tried both. First, he said, oh, you're just a pretty face, meaning I'm too stupid to be a member of Congress. I, of course, said thank you. And then the second comment was using a very unattractive picture, perhaps the most unattractive one he could find, where I was at a press conference talking about something that was upsetting and angering me, and my hair was blowing wildly. And he took that photo, and then he put a wash of green over the mailer, so I looked like a crazed woman who clearly shouldn't be given any power. And so the interesting thing about that, though, was it backfired, and it backfired among the women. The women were very angry that he used such an unattractive picture. And they would say, why did he do that? And what does she stand for anyway? And why is she running? Let's find out more about that young woman. And so I became relevant. But in general, those comments about appearance undermine us. And so I included a lot of stories. I included every, in my mind, every interesting or funny or unusual or challenging story. But the ones that affect women really more intensely is when they're younger. And so one of the stories I shared was when I was a young lawyer, and I had worked really hard on case for months and months and months, and canceled vacation, worked on weekends, worked till midnight, and in the celebratory dinner, my boss says, and I was running this case at the time, he's like, I want to thank Kirsten for her hard work, but don't you just love her haircut? Doesn't she look great? And this is in front of my peers when I'm a young associate trying to make my way to partner. And it was like a punch in the gut, because I felt at that moment that my boss didn't value me, that I was nothing more than how I looked. And those are the kind of comments that undermine us. And the reason why I included these illustrations in the book is so that young female reader can read the book and say, oh my God, that happened to me. And I want her to know she's not alone. She can not only push through it, she will make partner. Someday she can be that guy's boss, or at least set the tone and the climate of her company.
But, you know, I think a lot of men feel like they're giving people, you know, giving women a compliment. Even
for
the President
sure.
of the United States, Kamala, commented on your appearance, and it created sort of a little bit of a mini brouhaha. What did you make of that?
Well, I think in general, what we're all talking about is it's a distraction from the work we do.
Correct.
And so we should not allow ourselves to be distracted. Right. And so the way that I have approached my work is to try and not be distracted by things that are not relevant to why I'm doing this job and why I want to do the job, such as dealing with transnational criminal organizations and taking a delegation of attorneys general to Mexico City to talk about cross-border collaboration. We're doing a lot of work on elementary school truancy. We are doing work in terms of privacy and crimes committed through technology. We are doing work that for about 18 months involved foreclosed homeowners in California and bringing $20 billion of relief to the state. So that's where I put that.
Right.
I refuse to be distracted from the work that I need to get done. And, you know, in terms of what we talk with other women about, I appreciate everything that Kirsten has done, and I think that a lot of it is about also saying, don't be distracted, don't allow yourself to be distracted by that. And because
yeah.
it's actually something that is being sent your way that can put you in a place that you then start to, you don't want to identify with
and
that.
Possibly
it's just not productive
intentionally,
to identify
if not subconsciously.
And,
you know?
And that's why it's never about the one comment or who said it and when they said it, because it's about elevating the discussion to the broader notion, and this is something, Katie, you and I have talked about do we value women? Do we value women in the workplace? And when you have these scandals like the NFL scandal, where women are not being valued, where someone who beats his wife and has a video of him dragging her out of an elevator in the most disrespectful way is given a slap on the wrist, and you have a military that had 26,000 cases of rape and sexual assault last year alone and only 1 in 10 reporting, and you have college campuses where the institutional bias will put their arms very quickly around the favored student, the favored quarterback, whatever it is, it's the institutional biases that are maintaining the status quo that fundamentally are not valuing women. And then when you look at that in the same light of why are women only making 78 cents on the dollar, and if you're a Latina less, and if you're African American less, it's not right, and it's a drag on the economy, and it's something we should all be able to talk about what we can do to value the women among us so that our companies can perform at the highest level, so our government can perform at the highest level.
And of course, those issues all get more attention when a woman is in a leadership position. And I want to talk to you both about some of the issues that I know you care deeply about, because we don't want this to be all about gender equality, because it doesn't give credit to the extraordinary work you're both doing. And Kamala, I know as a prosecutor, you were made aware of certain things about the criminal justice system. And that's why you really have devoted a lot of your time, among other things, to the truancy issue in elementary school, right, which I was so surprised to hear it was such a problem. Tell us about it, why it's such a problem, and your efforts to correct it. Because some of the things you're doing are pretty controversial, right?
Probably, but you know, hopefully time will make it not so much.
Yeah.
So. Well, in terms of just my thoughts about criminal justice policy is a broad point. I think, again, there's been a false choice, which suggests that when we think of criminal justice policy, one is either soft on crime or tough on crime, instead of asking, are we smart on crime? In fact, I wrote a book called Smart on Crime. and really the theory comes as much, is influenced as much as anything by the public health model and what it tells us. If we are facing an epidemic, so you can call it a health epidemic or insert crime in place of health, the smartest, most efficient, most effective, most cost-effective way to address it is prevention. If we're a little too late and the sniffles have caught on, early intervention. But if we are addressing it in the emergency room or in the prison system, we are much too late and it's far too expensive. And so on the issue of elementary school truancy, I did a study of who the homicide victims were who were under the age of 25 when they were killed. Because we just accepted, and the natural correct response when we have a surge of homicides, let's put more cops on the street, what is our gang enforcement strategy, all of that. But let's also ask the question, who are they and what's going on? So the data came back, and it included the fact that of the homicide victims under the age of 25, 94% were high school dropouts. Not surprising. Went over to the school district. Of the chronically and habitually truant students, 40% were elementary school students, kindergarten through sixth grade, who were missing 50, 60, some of them up to 80 days of a 180-day school year. Now, we know that child will never be productive a day in their life. And so I decided to take it on. What was controversial about it is when I first started to deal with this as DA, and I've now been dealing with it as Attorney General, I decided I'd play the bad guy. And so it was actually before you asked about politics. It was before my reelection as district attorney. But I was so upset by this. I asked the superintendent of schools to convene a meeting for me with all the principals and administrators of the school district, which he did. And I stood in front of them in a high school auditorium, and I shared with them a fact about myself. I am a product of California public schools. My first grade teacher, Mrs. Frances Wilson, God rest her soul, attended my law school graduation. I would not be here were it not for the education I received. And I believe a child going without an education is tantamount to a crime.
Yeah.
So I declared then, bad guy, mm-hmm. I'm going to start prosecuting parents for truancy.
Mm.
If you know anything about San Francisco politics, you would know that there were tomatoes being thrown left, right, and center. I had no intention or desire to prosecute parents.
Yeah.
But shedding this infrared spotlight that we have of public safety on an issue that is a seemingly small issue,
right,
got the attention we needed, and we ended up, through a series of approaches, improving attendance by over 30%. As Attorney General, last year, I published the first study on elementary school truancy in the state of California. We had 1 million California elementary school students who were truant, 250,000 who missed over 10% of the school year, 44,000 who missed over 20% of the school year. It is well documented. An elementary school truant is 4 to 5 times likely to become a high school dropout. 82% of the prisoners in the United States are high school dropouts. When you look at the statistic in terms of African American men, an African-American man who's between the age of 30 and 34, if he is a high school dropout, is two-thirds likely to be in prison, have been in prison, or dead. The numbers and the statistics are absolutely clear. There's a very direct connection between public education and public safety. And so if we're going to be smart as in a system and effective, let's deal with it while we can actually have an impact. And it, by the way, even if you don't care about children, it's just going to be cheaper to deal with it then than addressing it later in our prison system. Or let's talk about it in terms of what we're not receiving in terms of workforce development, what we're receiving in terms of the burden on our public safety, public health, social services systems. So this is one example of some of the work that we're doing.
Well, clearly you're very passionate about that. And I think a woman would be more aware of that issue, don't you?
I think this goes to your broader point, Katie, that women's style of leadership, of seeing the different approach to solving a problem, seeing the full depth of a problem, having that different life experience, life perspective to inform you of how to solve this problem is unique, and it's something that's different. And that's why having women in leadership in all of these different industries is vital, because Kamala is going to look at an issue very differently than perhaps than a male colleague who may not focus on children first and might not see where does it start and where are the places where we as a society are failing. And then meeting those concerns. And I think that's one of the real signs of what women bring to the table.
Case in point, sexual assault in the military, an issue that you took on in an unprecedented way, something I care deeply about. You tried to get sort of the whole process out of the chain of command because it just is very difficult for a victim to go through the chain of command when something happens. Now you've set your sights on sexual assault on college campuses. It seems to me that I've cared about these issues for a long time, but we're at this watershed moment. Maybe the NFL, all the attention that was that it's gotten for violence against women, but you didn't have the five votes needed. Mm-hmm. And that must have been so frustrating. Are you going to keep trying? And
of course.
What do you think? I mean, Claire McCaskill was very much opposed to your bill. So what happened, do you think?
Well, obviously women are not a monolith. We're not going to agree on everything. But what this was showing, that if you listen to survivors, if you start with the story of the survivor who was brutally raped, tries to report it to her commander says it's your own fault and I'm not going to prosecute, I'm not going to do anything, that woman has no confidence that justice is possible in the existing system. So you have to create a system that can be reliable, that can be transparent, that can be accountable. And our allies have already done this. For civil liberties reasons, they've taken all the decision-making for serious crimes out of the chain of command because the chain of command's biased. They have asses to cover. They have agendas to accomplish. They don't want it to reflect poorly on their record. And so they are not taking charge of this one particular crime well at all. And since Dick Cheney was Secretary of Defense, they said zero tolerance for sexual assault in the military. But last year, 26,000 cases of unwanted sexual contact, rape, and sexual assault, and only 1 out of 10 of those even reporting. And of the brave souls that did report these crimes, 62% were retaliated against for reporting the crime. So you have a huge structural problem. And we will get this done. We will not give up. We will keep fighting for this. And while I was fighting this battle, two young ladies showed up to my office and said, well, Senator Gillibrand, we know you're tackling this in the military, but this is happening on college campuses. And so I sat down with two young women in their 20s, Andrea and Annie, and they said, we were raped, both at our schools in North Carolina. We reported the rape. We were not only disbelieved, but we were then blamed and retaliated against for bringing it to light. Instead of just taking it and not ever fighting back, they decided they would speak truth to power. They went to campus across the country. They've started a movement of young men and young women standing up to the administrations of their schools and saying, you must do better. You have to be able to protect students and have a safe environment. Title IX requires it.
I want to invite, by the way, people who have questions to approach the mic so we can get some of your questions in as well. Oh, look. Oh, I love it. Go ahead. I'm sorry, Kirsten. I didn't mean to interrupt.
So all I'm saying is this is an example of the reason why these issues were taken up by me is because I listened to these people's stories, men and women who suffered horrible things and not only understood it, but then fought back and tried to make sure their voices were heard throughout this process.
You know, I've prosecuted these cases in courtrooms, and I will tell you, it is more than one time that I stood before a jury and reminded the jury that the penal code was not designed just to protect Snow White. And that is critical when you're talking in particular about crimes that involve sex. Because there will be an incredible amount of judgment that is in the room, even if unspoken. And it goes back in history in terms of crimes against women. And you can talk about it from domestic violence to rape. What were you wearing? And so part of what has to happen in this approach is so critical, is speaking with victims in every way we can to let them know they will not be judged and that we will be there to protect them and make sure there is consequence and accountability for what happens. For example, some of the work that my office is doing most recently, and we're actually prosecuting one of the first cases, involves what has been called revenge porn. Well, I'm trying to change that name. So actually, I think we should call it cyber exploitation. Because the word porn, by the way, suggests that the woman in that situation where she was in a consensual relationship, she took a photograph that then gets posted by the ex-boyfriend to embarrass her, right? To suggest that she was engaged in pornography implicitly suggests that she was doing something wrong. And again, it's about changing the language and how we think about issues that involve sex. And doing it in a way that does not send signals explicit or subtle to victims that if they come forward, they're going to be ridiculed at the worst, but judged harshly in a way that doesn't allow them to really be able to be whole because there's been consequence and accountability for bad behaviors and illegal conduct, criminal conduct.
I know California just passed a yes means yes, which was a pretty, obviously.
I like the way Gloria Steinem wrote about it. She's like, there's nothing more erotic than a yes. Why wouldn't they want a yes means yes standard? I thought it was the best take on the whole debate.
But, I'm just curious because as lawyers, do you ever worry, it's oftentimes on a college campus, this toxic combination of alcohol and hormones miscommunication. Do you worry about due process at all?
Of course.
In those circumstances?
There is no benefit for a perpetrator to go free any more than an innocent person being accused. It is not helpful on any level that, and we tried to make this case in the military context. We don't want every case prosecuted. That's not our goal. Our goal is to have someone who's actually trained, a prosecutor who's a military experience, weigh the evidence carefully, and if there's evidence a crime was committed, then go forward. We don't want every case going forward.
You want it fairly adjudicated.
Because if you have a lot of acquittals, that's not going to create confidence in the system. You want cases that have evidence going forward, and you just want that survivor to know she'll be heard. She'll have a fair shot. If there's enough evidence to prosecute, it will be prosecuted.
The administration won't cover it up, won't discourage her from reporting.
Correct.
And the local police departments, by the way, won't do the same. Can I take some audience questions?
Yeah, go for it.
Okay, hi. Is that Lucy?
Hi, Katie.
Hi, Lucy.
Hi, Senator. You're my senator. I adore you.
Sounds like my captain.
It's true. All right, so I've spent a lifetime of trying to enable women through journalism and writing and editing, and I edited a magazine called Self for 12 years, and I call myself a feminist, and it's so unpopular. Mm-hmm. And I keep saying to women who say to me that they're not that political, and I'm like, gosh, I really disagree with that. If you care about the water you drink and the quality of the air and your body and who has control over it. But there's one thing that really, really pisses me off. And that is that today, you were talking about valuing women, 78 cents on the dollar is what I'm gonna make. And I keep saying to women, let's talk about time. I'm a mom. What if I had to work 10 hours and my male colleague had to work 8 for the same pay? It's the same math. I have to work 20% longer for the same pay. So there's this little law called the Equal Pay Act, 1963, signed into law by my favorite president, John F. Kennedy. Back then, equal pay was not really even in the offing. So he said, hey, women make 59 cents on the dollar. That's not fair. Let's make it fair. Let's make the Equal Pay Act.
So
we're not
Lucy,
doing any better.
So is the question, what's going on with that?
Yeah, okay. You guys, I worship you. You're all in a position to say, let's make it equal.
So right.
What's wrong with equal?
Why hasn't it happened?
So my goal is to ask every American woman to be heard on that issue. And I believe if every American woman, regardless of whether you lived in a red state or a blue state or a purple state, was heard on that issue and told their congressman, told their mayor, told their governor, this is my priority. You have to do this for the benefit of the U.S. economy. We haven't asked for much. Women are the reason why President Obama was elected. What did we ask for that election? What did we say you must get done? And my answer to that is nothing. We've asked for nothing. And that is what is our greatest challenge, that if we could be heard, if we could demand action from our elected leaders on things we deeply care about, whether it's equal pay, whether it's paid leave, whether it's universal pre-K or affordable daycare, or whether it's decision-making of our health care and reproductive choices, it doesn't matter what the issue we care about is. It's that we have to ask to have it be done, and we have to be heard in every way we can. So we have a bill. Of course we have a bill. It's illegal to pay a woman less than a man, but there's no transparency. And today, you can't ask your employer, you can't ask a guy you work with how much do you make and not risk losing your job, because you're not allowed to talk about it. If the company wants to fire you for that reason, they may be able to do that. So that's all our bill does, creates more disclosure, more transparency, more incentives for companies to let people compare wages and incentivize them to actually post their wages per job to make sure they can test themselves that they're not paying women less. But it's really challenging, and for young women, this is something they don't typically know. Any industry, you pick it, even a female-dominated industry, the men in that industry are paid more. Teaching, you'd say, surely women are paid more. No, men are. Nursing, surely, no, men are. The only industry where women are paid more is therapy, because we're very good listeners. but it is something we all have to ask for and fight for. And one of my biggest worries is that the women's movement is dead, and that if we're going to revive it, it means that every American woman has to be heard on what she cares about. And then we can create a movement that could perhaps change some of these outcomes.
I think it's important to add to those statistics that as compared to white non-Hispanic men, white women make 78 cents on the dollar. African-American women make 64 cents on the dollar. Latinas make 53 cents on the dollar. And when we look at the associated issues, I think it's always important in the same conversation to talk about what is available in terms of childcare, affordable or free childcare. Looking at the elementary school truancy issue, for example, of the cases that I've seen, it was that mom that you described who was holding down two jobs. And so she comes home and she's barely holding it together. So many days she says to the 7-year-old, stay home and take care of the 2-year-old. So I can go to do the job to keep the roof over the head and the warm meal on the plate. She wants everything the best for her children, but she's just trying to hold it together. She needs access to childcare. So there are a few issues that are directly related to this, that when we talk about lifting up women and in terms of their economic status, childcare is a very, very big part of that conversation, and it's something that we can all do not only at a federal level but at a state level in demanding that working parents, whatever gender, are able to raise a family. That's part of the American dream. Well, where are those kids going to go before they start kindergarten, which, by the way, is not full day and should be.
Yeah. And universal pre-K should be
exactly right. Exactly right.
It would make a huge difference, not just for the parent who's trying to figure it out, but for the country. Every dollar you put in early childhood education, you get $11 out. So it is a win-win for everyone.
Well, there's so much more to talk about. I'm so bummed we're out of time because we didn't get to talk about Hillary Clinton in 2016.
Go Hillary.
About your future ambitions, because a lot of people who are attorney general become governor. A lot of people who are a senator run for president. Just saying, hashtag just saying. But anyway, thank you all so much for being
here.
And thank you for your questions.